I did.
Okay, so
the right choice.
We've got this reaction. We've got some data that show us how the concentration of NO is changing over time.
Yes.
How do we figure out the order with respect to NO?
Ready to chance to plot it?
Well, we could try to calculate the rates, right? Like we did the other day, I could say, okay, what is the rate at the beginning of the experiment? What is the rate at the end of the experiment? And if it is constant, we know it's zero order, right?
Yes.
If it's not constant, we could plug in the concentration and the rates and do sort of a method of initial rates kind of thing, right? So we could say, all right, let's figure out what's going on at time zero. The rate at time zero is the change in the concentration of NO over the change in time, which it looks like it's going from 5 times 10 to the 8th, 6 times 10 to the 8th, and it's going from 100 seconds, or 0 to 100, sorry, this is milliseconds. So it's about negative 1.0 times 10 to the 6th molecules per cubic centimeter millisecond. Okay, then let's try it. Where should we try to calculate the next rate?
700 to 1000.
Okay, so the rate at 700 milliseconds, it's changing. Let's see, the final is 9.9 times 10 to the 7th. The initial was 1.7 times 10 to the 8th. Final time is 1,000 milliseconds. The initial is 700 milliseconds. Who's got a calculator?
Oh, you got 7.1 times 10 to the 7th over 300.
Thank you.
Oh, you want a decimal?
I want a number.
Oh, okay.
So we'll do 9.9, 2.7 minus 1.78.
2.7 of something is like
divide that by
100.
Okay. So I get negative 2.3 times 10 to the 5th. Molecules per cubic centimeter per millisecond. So is the rate constant?
No.
No. So is it zeroth order?
No.
No. So now what we can do is we can say, well, the rate at time zero is going to be equal to K times the concentration of NO to some order times the concentration of O3 to some other order. And we're going to compare that to the rate at 700, which has the same rate law. So, negative 1 times 10 to the 6th over negative 2.4 times 10 to the 5th. We don't know what K is, but it doesn't matter. It's constant, so when we divide K by K, it's 1. O3, we don't know the order of it. They tell us it's 1 times 10 to the, I think, 14th molecules per cubic centimeter, but it doesn't matter because they're saying it's basically constant. So that's going to be 1 as well. So now we could say, well, at time 0, my concentration was 6.0 times 10 to the 8th. At 700, it was 1.7 times 10 to the 8th. So what do we get? Negative 1 times 10 to the 8th divided by negative 2.6 to the 6th. Divided by negative 2.4 to the 5th. 4.16.
Oh, yeah, we have power.
6.0 times 10 to the 8th divided by 1.7 times 10 to the 8th is the same as 6 divided by 1.7. We get 3.5.
probably like one.
If we're looking for an integer, it's probably one, right? Okay? If we take the, if we do the logarithm of both sides and move that x out of the way, we can actually calculate the log of 4.16 divided by the log of 3.5. We're actually getting an x of 1.13, so yeah, x is 1. There's an easier way to do this.
Using the
question.
What if like x was like 1.5?
Then you did something wrong. Okay. Go back and take new data.
Well, couldn't it be a 3.5?
That's a little hint for the iodine clock reaction. If you're getting 1.5, you either gotta just guess high or low, or if you want to get it right, redo your data.
Couldn't it be a 3.5? It's not like
not very likely.
What's going
to be? Not very likely. Okay, what's the easier way to do this?
Use
What is it? I
don't know.
Yeah. Graph it.
Yeah.
Graph
it. Literally, I was just like, graph it.
I'm going to use my very favorite graphing program.
Graph.com.
Yeah.
Is it Desmos?
No, it is Excel.
No, it's Excel.
What?
Oh, of course it's Excel.
You didn't know that?
You excel at graphing, don't you?
That's right.
Oops.
Okay. 6.0 times 10 to the 8th. I don't think it knows how to do that. So I got to hit equals. Boom. Equals 5.0 times 10.
Your thing is frozen.
Oh, sorry. Boom. Look at how quick I am. Equals 2.4 times 10 caret 8 equals 1.7 times 10 to the 8.
9.9
times 10. Okay, so here's our data. If we want to know what order this is, let's try graphing concentration versus time. Wah, wah. Don't need that because we've only got one data set.
Well, couldn't
this title sucks.
Well, couldn't you put all the data sets in there?
Yes, but if the scales are vastly different, I don't remember what the scales were.
Oh, yeah.
Of how much we're using. If the scales are different, we're not going to tell whether it's linear or not. Okay? So, this is really a test. We're going to see whether it is linear. So I'm going to insert a trend line, a linear one. I'm going to display the equation and the R-squared value.
Well, that looks pretty good to me.
0.95! That's fantastic if we're doing education research. We're not. We're doing science. We've got to get better than 0.95. So let's do a first order test. First order test, we need to find the natural log of the concentration of NO. So I hit equals.
We couldn't define the logarithm.
ln. I click on that, so it's saying take the natural logarithm of whatever's in V2. I hit enter and it does it. Bam. I click where I just put that formula. I move my cursor to the bottom right and it turns into a tiny black plus. I click and drag and it does it for all of them. Thank you. Now I'm going to highlight my natural log of my concentrations, hold control and highlight my times, and make another graph. Boom.
Jay Leno.
What? Come on, linear. Come on, linear. Boom! 0.9999.
It's about time. Oh,
God.
That is very, very good. 0.99999. For completeness, if I want, I can try the second order test by making Excel calculate 1 over the concentrations and then graphing that.
So we get a computer on the top quiz?
Yeah. You guys take a look at your problem set yet?
Nope.
Take a look at the free response problems on your problem set.
Oh, we're given the graph.
Yeah, they give you the graph.
That's crazy.
Wow.
Yeah, so second order is only 0.93, so it's not second order, it's clearly first order.
You gotta do weighted averages in the first year.
Ooh, a 2000.
Then you get your real one.
Okay, so now we've determined that the order with respect to NO is 1. So our rate law is K times the concentration of NO to the first times the concentration of O3 to the Y. We don't know. So now we've got to do the same thing, but we've got to plug in our data. And see how O3 is changing. And really, this is a nice thing about doing it on Excel. All I have to do is change these numbers.
Oh my lord.
Whoa! Yeah. Wait. That would've been tough.
Where are these? Oh, that's where the name of the numbers.
Whoa.
Yeah. Wait, can you not like copy paste it in or not?
What?
Is there not a copy paste?
Yeah, I'm copying and pasting the times 10 to the 9. Okay, so now I've plugged in my new times and my new concentrations. These are actually O3s if I really want to be doing it right. Okay, I definitely need that. Okay, now when we look at it, what order is it?
Oh my god. That's first.
Okay. So that is how we use the integrated rates. We graph those things, we do the three tests, whichever one is linear, that's the order. Okay? But in order to do this, we have to make sure the other reactant is at a very, very high concentration. All right? Okay, what else do we got to do? What is the overall rate law? Boom, we got it. What is the value of the rate constant for each set of experiments?
Oh, okay. Well, you already had the equation, didn't you?
Well, we want the rate constant, right? We want K.
Yeah.
So we need the rate, we need the concentration of NO, we need the concentration of O3. Well, the rate. Nope. Part of the reason this method doesn't work as well when you already have concentrations and times is because, remember, we're looking for the tangent line.
Yeah.
We're looking at we really want the slope at exactly this point.
Yeah,
but 100 milliseconds has gone by, right? So in those 100 milliseconds, the rate might have changed just slightly so that our rate that we're calculating is not the true instantaneous rate. So with this method, it's actually pretty hard to calculate your K value. What we can do, look at the graph.
Yeah.
Right? If it's first order, then we know that this number right here that's in front of the X, the slope of that first order test tells us what?
It's K double prime.
That tells us our K value. Okay? So if this is the second experiment where we're doing the O3, our K value is 0.0036. Not negative, right? Because slope is negative K.
Wait, so then if we did it with the NO concentration, it's
going to
be the same, right?
We should get the same value. It's a constant. So yeah, it should be the same for both of them. We could try the other one. Okay. So what did they plug in for NO?
Go back to the question.
In experiment 2, NO was 2 times 10 to the 14th. 1. O3 was 1 times 10 to the 10th. We were just answering the rate constant.
Oh.
Sorry. Rate constant, we just look at the graph. It's the slope. So if I go back and undo everything I did, so we can get to our... Okay, this was the other experiment. In the other experiment, it's 0.0018.
No, it said that the k primes for each one. Or the k's for each one. So
it did ask us the k's for each one.
Yeah, k prime and k double prime.
Okay. There's a reason. There's a reason that they're not exactly the same. Because when we find the slope of this line, we're not actually finding the rate constant. We're finding what's called the pseudo rate constant.
What is that?
It's sort of like a rate constant, but only because we've made the concentration of the other things so high that we can ignore it. This value k prime is actually the true rate constant times the concentration of O3. Right? This actually isn't correct. This is something we're going to have to do in the crystal violet experiment as well. We're going to deal with what's called a pseudo rate constant, and then once we figure that out, we can figure out the true rate constant. Okay, so they're saying the rate is some pseudo constant times NO to the X. Well, we already found that X was 1, right? So now if we can find that rate from the first experiment, I gotta think about this. Yeah, this K prime should be the K prime from the graph. The other one was the k prime from the other graph. So we were getting 0.0036 for one of them and 0.00 flipped. This one, k prime was 0.0018. And k double prime for the O3 experiment was 0.0036. Right? Now, if we think about it, I'll start with K double prime. This little equation here is like this equation, except I've combined the concentration of NO and my K value, right? So K prime is really the true K value times the concentration of NO.
Well, didn't they give what it was?
Yeah.
Okay.
So if we know K double prime is 0.0036, and we know that the concentration of NO...
It's like, yeah, you have to go down.
Yeah. Oh, 2.4 times 10 to the 14th.
Why is it K double prime, not
K? I'm just going to do this one first. For this one...
So it's concentration of O3 then?
Yeah. Well, K double prime is the pseudo rate constant for the experiment where we were actually changing the O3 concentration. Mm-hmm. Okay? So this rate law is basically the rate law that corresponds to second set of data that I collected. Won't let me? When I went through and did all the stuff for O3, right, that K value that I was finding there was really just a pseudo rate constant. Because that K value didn't factor in the NO at all. Okay? We can still tell what order it is because the O3 concentration is roughly constant, but this K value is not the true K for the experiment because it doesn't actually factor in the NO. So what we have to do is actually plug in the NO concentration, which was
2.0
times 10 to the 14th, and then we can solve for the true K. Be a good band name.
1.8 times 10 to the
14th. We are true K.
1.8 times
10
to the negative 17th.
What is it?
1.8 times 10 to the negative 17th.
Now, let's see if we get the same answer when we do it for the other experiment. So, if K prime, right, this pseudo rate constant here is really our true rate constant times the concentration of O3 to the first. And in the first experiment, it said O3 was 1 times 10 to the 14th. So this is 0.0018 equals our true K times 1.0 times 10 to the 14th. I get the same value. Okay? Whew! So yeah, it was because that graph was not really telling us the true rate constant, it was telling us a pseudo rate constant. It was telling us the rate constant times the concentration of the thing we were keeping constant. Okay, that's one of the limitations to the graphical method. It doesn't tell you the true rate constant. All right, then what do we got to do? We just figured out the rate constant for the overall reaction, and now it says determine the concentration of NO in experiment 1 after 500 or 1500 milliseconds.
I think I use the
Okay, so this is actually the true rate law for this reaction. But if I want to know the concentration of NO in experiment 1 after 1500 milliseconds, well, what I actually want to do is I want to use the equation that we found when we were just testing the NO. That was here, right? Okay. So if we know that.
Why are you on the
If we know that for this experiment, that the rate is 0.0018 times the concentration of NO to the first power, right? If this number is really our K double prime, then this equation right here, the first order equation, really should look like this. The natural log of the concentration of NO at some time is equal to negative 0.0018
times t
plus the natural log of the initial concentration of NO. So if we started with an initial concentration of 6 times 10 to the 8th, we're talking about 1500 milliseconds, we can solve and figure out the new concentration. Although you gotta know the rules of logarithms. 0.0018 times 1500 is 2.7. That should be negative though, right? What's the natural log of 6 times 10 to the 8th? 8.12.
Two one two.
2.12. That should equal the natural log of our new concentration. So, subtract 2.7 from that. So our natural log of our new concentration is equal to 17.5. How do I undo the logarithm? Exponentiate both sides. So e to the natural log of the concentration will give us the concentration. E to 17.512. That should be our new concentration of NO molecules. What is that? 4.0 times 10 to the 7th?
Yeah.
Molecules. Does that seem reasonable?
Sure.
Sure. 10 to the 8th, 10 to the 8th, 10 to the 8th, 10 to the 7th. Okay, we've gone quite a bit further here, so cut this in half, 4 times 10 to the 7th, that seems reasonable. Okay? One thing I forgot to do in this problem. Units! Units!
Yeah, molecules per cubic centimeter.
There's no units on my K. K needs units. K always needs units. The question is, what are the units?
Centimeters to the 6th over molecules squared. Or something, I don't know, whatever.
Or let's go cancel it all out, never mind. Now we're trying to figure that one out.
He's close. We want our rate to be in molecules per cubic centimeter per millisecond. Normally we're talking about moles per liter per second or moles per liter per minute or something like that, but in this problem we're saying molecules per cubic centimeter per millisecond.
So centimeters.
This is in molecules per cubic centimeter, and it's raised to the 1 power, being multiplied by something that is also in molecules per cubic centimeter raised to the 1st power, right? So basically we got to get rid of one of these, and we have to give ourselves a millisecond.
So molecules per cubic centimeter over.
So it's actually
one over
molecules per cubic centimeter. So we could say cubic centimeters per molecule.
Well, you got cubic centimeters.
Actually, I'm going to do that.
Millisecond cubic centimeter.
Per molecule times millisecond. Those are the units. I can't remember if we asked you to do this in the problem set or not, but I'm going to do it right now because we're on the subject. If we have some rate law that is zero order, what are the units of K?
Well, what are we trying to get the rate in?
Say it's in molar per second.
There you go.
Then K is in molar per second, right?
Oh, it's going to be that one rule.
If it's first order, what units does K need to be if our rate is in molar per second?
Inverse seconds.
1/2 seconds. If we're second order,
well, you got 1 mole second, or 1/1 mole second?
1/1 molar seconds. Or sometimes you'll see this as liters per mole times seconds.
Wait, what unit are we talking about?
We're saying for a second order, this is the order.
Mm-hmm.
What are the units of K?
Meters per second.
All right, now this again is assuming that we want the rate to be in molar per second, which is a pretty common unit for rates. Dimensional analysis, yes. If it's third order,
1/1 molar squared seconds.
1/1 molar squared seconds. It's fourth order? three. One over molar cubed seconds, right? So, questions?
No
questions? All right.
Oh, wait, I have a question.
Oh, question.
Go over the pseudo,
this concept of a pseudo rate constant?
Yeah.
Okay. So, when you are doing one of these graphical methods, when I do a, say, first order test, can I graph the natural log of the concentration of something over time? Well, this graph is not truly representing the overall behavior of the system because we're artificially inflating one of the concentrations to be so high that it doesn't change. Okay? So when we do this method, we're keeping one concentration so high that it's not actually affecting the shape of this graph, but it's still affecting the rate. Just because we cut the concentration of O3 so high that we could ignore it, doesn't mean it doesn't affect the reaction. It's still affecting the rate of the reaction. So when we do this test and we get a straight line and we get our equation, the slope of this is actually not the true rate constant. It's always a pseudo rate constant. It's gonna be some K prime.
Because it depends on the concentration of the liquid.
Because we haven't actually factored in what the O3 is doing, right? This is our true rate law, but what we're doing is just looking at part of that rate law when we do this sort of method, okay? So if we're actually looking at the rate as just a function of the changing NO, then the K value here is actually a combination of the true K and the concentration of O3. So then I can just plug in, I don't remember where I did that, I think I erased it.
Yeah.
I think it was here, and then I
erased it.
Oh no, I wrote it somewhere else. So if I calculate my K prime here to be some value, well, I know that that's the true K times the concentration of the other reactant. In this case, it was O3. Alright, so then if I know the order with respect to O3, I can actually plug in here and solve for that actual rate constant. Okay? Cool.
Yeah.
Thanks for asking that question, because that is going to come up in the crystal violet lab and you are going to be confused by it. So now you can just go to the YouTube video and go to the very, very end, and you'll know that's when I talked about
pseudo rate
constant. A what?